Everybody, welcome to this class. Hope all of you are safe and fine at your home. We are at home due to the disease COVID-19. School is closed, but the online classes are going on. And you all are taking care of yourself, but still I have some tips for you how to protect yourself. When coughing and sneezing, cover mouth and nose with flexed elbow or tissue. Throw tissue into closed bin immediately after use. Clean hands with alcohol-based hand rub, soap and water after coughing or sneezing and when caring for the sick. Hope you, all of you know it, regularly following it also, and hope you will follow till we come out from this situation. Children, every day is a fresh start. With this beautiful quotation, we'll start our chapter 2, that is your types of hardware. We'll cover the topics, introduction, computer system and overview, memory in a computer system, input devices, output devices, all these topics we'll cover in this lesson. So, lesson name is your types of hardware. Before we start the types of hardware, you know that what is hardware. Hardware means the tangible parts of the computer, means which you can touch and feel, are known as your hardware. Actually, computer works with two parts, you know, one is your hardware and one is your software. Parts which we can touch and feel are known as your hardware. Parts which we can not touch are the programs and instructions which help in running the computer, giving us the output, processing our data are known as your software. So types of hardware will cover CPU, memory, input devices and output devices. You can tell the whole hardware of the computer is categorized into these five types. Main part is your CPU. Then inside the CPU memory is there, input devices using which we are giving data to the computer, output devices using which we are getting our output. So first we will learn about CPU. CPU consists of three parts, ALU means arithmetic logic unit, one is your memory unit, another one is your control unit. In the previous chapter means chapter 1, you have learn detail about these all units. ALU, arithmetic logic unit, is used for calculation. Memory is used to store the data. Control unit is actually control all the other units of the computer. But today we'll learn about the memory. Computer memory are of two types. One is your primary memory, another one is your secondary memory. Primary memories are again of two types, one is your RAM, another one is your ROM. Secondary memory in different forms we are using, hard disk, pen drive, CD, DVD, these all are your secondary memory. Primary memory means it is computer's own memory. So what is the use of memory in a computer? Suppose I will give one example, IPO cycle already you have studied in the first chapter, input, process, output cycle, in which user provides the data, computer processes the data and gives us the output. But one simple example take, suppose we want to multiply the two numbers 5 and 7. We will give an instruction to the computer, multiply 5 and 7. Actually this multiply is here the instruction and 5 and 7 are here input, means the data will provide to the computer. Using this multiply instruction, CPU will process the data and provides the output. CPU starts processing the data when the input operation is completed. That means, see, whenever we enter the data or provide the data to the computer, at that time CPU waits. It will not start any type of processing. When the input operation by the user will be completed, then only the CPU starts processing the data. So suppose you have entered 5, then next time we'll enter 7. So when we are entering 7, where 5 will go and store? So file will go and store in the RAM of the computer. RAM means the primary memory of the computer. That means all the input data will go and store in the RAM for a temporary period of time. When the input operation will complete, then the CPU will start processing the data and then gives us the output. Then after processing also, it needs a place to store the result permanently. That means we can use a secondary storage devices. Generally, we store the data in our hard disk. So what is then memory? Memory is used to store data in it. Then comes to units of memory, like other quantity, time, distance, measuring units are there. Similarly, for measuring computer memory, units are there. All of you know computer understands only one language, that is your binary language. Binary is a Greek word where bi means two, nary means number. That means it understands two numbers only. That is, you know that one is either a zero or a one. Zero represents off state and one represents on state. So using this zero and one, computer stores all the data, and this 011 is used to measure the units of memory of the computer also. Encoding scheme. What is this encoding scheme? It is a method of specifying binary codes for each character internally. That means computer understands only binary language. So whatever data we provide, that stores in the form of 0 and 1. So it uses different type of schemes to store those binary codes. 2 or 1 is your ASCII code, American Standard Code for Information Interchange. Another one is your Unicode. Many other codes are there, encoding schemes are there, using which computer can store the data. But nowadays, everywhere we are using ASCII, American Standard Code for Information Interchange. So how using this ASCII computer stores the data? You know that 0 and 1 known as a bit. Bit stands for binary digit. What is ASCII and what is Unicode? These both are your encoding schemes. But if an ASCII encoding scheme will be used by a computer, it represents a group of characters such a group of 8 bits or 1 byte. That means each character will take 1 byte to store inside the computer. If an Unicode scheme will be used, it represents a group of characters as a group of 16 bits or 2 bytes. For example, I will give an example to make you understand this. Suppose you want to store the word carefully. Kerli word, the word Kerli consists of 7 characters. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 characters. In ASCII code, see, it will take 7 bytes because it takes 1 byte for each character. But same thing if you go for Unicode, it will take 14 bytes because it takes 2 bytes for each character. Let us take another example. Suppose you want to store the word computer. Computer consists of 8 characters. If it is a, you will use ASCII, then it will take 8 bytes because each character takes 1 byte and 8 character will take 8 bytes. If you will go for Unicode, then it will take 16 bytes because each character takes 2 bytes and computer consists of 8 characters and each character contains 2 bytes. So 2 into 18, 8, 16 bytes. This way, computer stores each character of the keyboard internally. If ASCII code will be used, for each character at least 1 byte. And if Unicode will be used, it will be 2 bytes for each character. If any other scheme will use, different bytes will be used. Hope you understand this, how this ASCII and Unicode differs from each other. Now come to units of computer memory measurements. You know that either a 0 or 1 is known as a bit. Bit stands for binary digit. When 8 bits will combine together, they will make 1 byte. And when 1024 bytes will combine together, it will make 1 kilobyte. When 1024 kilobyte will be together, then 1 megabyte. Then 1024 megabyte will make 1 gigabyte. 1024 gigabyte will make 1 terabyte. 1024 terabyte will make 1 petabyte. And 1024 petabyte will make 1 exabyte. In this, you can tell the smallest unit is our bit and the largest unit is our exabyte. So this is a table for measuring using a table used for measuring computer memory. You will learn this table, it will help you. So how these memory units are used, we use in our daily life. For that we will do some problems. Suppose a property such as storage capacity of 1.44 megabyte. What is this approximately in bytes and gigabytes? That means if 1.44 megabytes will convert into bytes and it is in gigabytes, how will convert? 1 megabyte is, you know, it is 1024 kilobyte. 1.44 megabyte will be 1.44 into 1024 kilobyte. Approximately it will be 1.474 kilobyte. And for 2 kilobytes will again convert to bytes. 1 kilobyte is your 1024 bytes. So again we will multiply with 1024 to get the bytes. 1024 megabyte is your 1 gigabyte. 1 megabyte is equal to 1 by 1024 gigabyte. 1.44 MB will be 1.44 divided by 1024 GB, that is equal to 0.001 GB approximately. Hope you understand this calculation. Clearly I have written how to convert megabyte to byte and megabyte to gigabytes. If you will not understand, you can message me through campus care. I will explain you again. Another problem is also there. A program is distributed on properties. If the size of the whole program is 10 MB, what is the minimum number of properties required to store 10 megabyte of data? One property's capacity is your 1.44 MB, 10 megabyte, 10 by 1.44, that is 6.944, approximately 7 if you are rounding up, so we will need nearly 7 properties. This type of question you will get to convert different units using different units of computer memory. So more programs will do later on. Now come to primary memory. Computer has two types of memory. One is your primary memory, another one is your secondary memory. We will discuss about primary memory. It is also known as your main memory or internal memory of the computer, or you can tell that it is computer's own memory. All these memories are directly accessed by the processor. These memories are limited in capacity and manufactured by using integrated circuits IC or semiconductor device. Its speed of data accessing is faster than secondary memory. It is more expensive than secondary memory. Primary memory are again of two types, RAM and ROM, already we have discussed. But RAM are of two types, one is your SRAM, another one is your DRAM. Similarly, ROM are of different types also, PROM, EPROM and EEPROM. Actually, ROM is a permanent memory. You know that it is a read-only memory. It cannot, its contents cannot be altered. But nowadays, technology developed. We are able to remove the contents of the RAM sometimes. So, it is one is your programmable read-only memory, electrically erasable programmable read-only memory, electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. SRAM stands for static RAM. DRAM stands for dynamic RAM. PROM stands for programmable read-only memory. EPROM stands for erasable programmable read-only memory. EEPROM stands for electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. So what is SRAM and what is DRAM? SRAM stands for static RAM. DRAM stands for dynamic RAM. SRAM, whatever we are using, that is SRAM, static RAM, which is volatile and but it is costly and it don't need refreshing, but DRAM always needs a refreshing and it is lower cost than your SRAM. So next come to characteristics of RAM. RAM stands for random access memory. It is a form of data storage that can be accessed randomly at any time in any order by CPU. That is why it is known as your random access memory. So you can ask here, why RAM is known as your random access memory? Because the data can be accessed from RAM randomly at any time in any order by the CPU. That's why we call it as random access memory. RAM has limited storage capacity. All of you know RAM comes in the form of 2GB, 4GB, 6GB, 8GB. So it is limited storage. It is volatile. Volatile means what? As soon as the power goes up, contents lost from RAM. It is read-write memory. That means data we can store, we can read from RAM and we can store it in also in data in RAM. That's why it is known as a read-write memory. But it has some limitations. Without RAM, we cannot work in a computer or in a computer that all of you know. RAM is one important part of the computer because whatever program we use, first it loaded into to RAM, then user is able to use that program. So without RAM, we cannot do any type of work. But still, RAM has some disadvantages. That is limited storage capacity and volatile in nature. Due to this limited storage capacity and volatile nature, we need the secondary storage devices to store our data permanently and in a large volume. Also, that we'll discuss later. Now come to the characteristics of ROM. ROM is a read-only memory, all of you know. It is a permanent memory of the computer. It contains a set of startup instructions, that is what to do when a computer is turned on. It is non-volatile, means its contents are retained even when the device is powered off. That means it is a permanent memory and it stores some instructions which helps the computer in booting process. When we start our computer, it collects the information from the ROM to start that computer or any that device, and that programs or that instructions are stored permanently in ROM. And it is not lost when the device is powered up. But these disadvantages there also. We cannot write or we cannot save anything to the RAM. Whatever already stored during the manufacturing time of the RAM, that only we can use for starting process of our computer. One is IaaS. One term is there. What is this? IaaS stands for Immediate Access Storage. Both RAM and ROM are referred to as IaaS because CPU can access the data so quickly compared to data in backing storage, the secondary memory. You must have feel also that whenever you are using any outside devices like pen drive, CD, it takes some time to process the data and the opening of the file and other things for accessing the data. But RAM is faster than the secondary storage devices. That's why it is known as immediate access storage. Both primary memory are known as immediate access storage because CPU can access the data quickly in compared to our secondary memory. Then another term is there, three-pointer. It is a software program permanently installed to a hardware device such as a keyboard, hard drives, BIOS. BIOS means basic input-output system or video cards. It is programmed to give permanent instructions to communicate with other devices and perform functions like basic input-output tasks. It is typically stored in the flash ROM of hardware device. Flash ROM means where we can reprogram it. That is the one type of ROM where it can be reprogrammed until it is flash ROM. So this type of software is stored in hardware devices and it contains the information to run keyboard, hard drives and basic input output system or video cards. And with this, we come to the end of today's class. Thank you.